start our message, I first of all would like to express my appreciation to this association, to the delegations from the various churches we met with yesterday and the day before to conduct the business of the Bethlehem Association. I trust as your moderator that I will not disappoint you. And there possibly be times that you will think I have disappointed you, but with your prayers and your support and your help, I'll do my very best to do what I think is right and what is good for the Bethlehem Association. Today, as we have met together for this great memorial service, as I listen to the many names that were called, those that have already outstripped us in life in the last year, 64. I thought, my, how fast our people are going out into eternity. That list that you heard today were men and women, brothers and sisters, in the Lord Jesus Christ who died in the Lord. And if they died in the Lord, then today we should not weep for them, but we should rejoice for them. Because their labors are over, and their trials and all of the temptations have come to an end. Now they're in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ rejoicing. I found this morning as I was reading my study, and I thought this will fit just exactly where we need today. Here is a poem that I found, and I'd like to read this poem in memory of those 64. Only gone beyond the shadows to the realms of the endless day, only held in sweet communion where the tears have passed away. You're blending with the angels in their chorus around the throne. Now you'll never know more sorrow. You've a mansion all your own. You have met the lovely bridegroom. And the friends who've gone before. And you would not journey earthward. Though you love us as of yore, for your hands are filled with treasure, and your soul is thrilled with grace. Joy we cannot have imagined now reflects from your dear face. Oh, so suddenly you left us for your mansion in the sky. In a twinkling you were raptured, you could scarcely say goodbye. But we'll meet you soon in heaven, in that land so bright and fair. And we'll say a glad good morning, never more to part up there. While on earth you love to hear it, a sweet hymn we now recall. Though I cannot understand it, yet I know he knows it all. 'Tis the comfort as we sorrow, and the thorns our way oppose, that in heaven grow the roses, all the rest my Father knows. We shall journey on with patience, brave in Jesus' precious name, till the day we meet in heaven, and we're changed, but still the same. And your memory will be blessed, as this earth we sadly roam, and we'll live the more for Jesus, who has brought you safely home. May these words today comfort the families of those who have already outstripped you in life and gone on to be with Jesus. I don't know how everybody believes. I know that everybody doesn't believe like I believe. But I believe that when a saint of God dies, that saint immediately goes to be present with the Lord. Paul said to be absent from this body was to be present with the Lord. I believe that those today that we weep and mourn over, that we should not weep, as Paul said, as those that have no hope. For one of these days, God willing, we'll meet them again. At this memorial service today, we'd like to speak from a few verses of Scripture that might refresh your minds and might help you to remember the words of the Lord Jesus Christ Himself, giving us a hope and a promise that just as soon as life comes to a close for us here, that He's got something far greater and better than anything that we've ever experienced here in this life. In the 16th chapter of John's Gospel, Jesus, speaking unto His disciples, speaking of His death and His resurrection and the second advent, Jesus said, "A little while, and ye shall not see me, and again a little while, and ye shall see me, because I go to my Father." Then said some of His disciples among themselves, "What is this that He saith unto us, a little while, and ye shall not see me, and again a little while, and ye shall see me, because I go to the Father?" They said therefore, "What is this that He saith, a little while?" We cannot tell what He said. Now Jesus knew that they were desirous to ask Him, and said unto them, "Do ye inquire among yourselves of that I said, a little while, and ye shall not see me, and again a little while, and ye shall see me? Verily, verily, I say to you, that ye shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice, and ye shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned into joy. A woman, when she is in travail, has sorrow, because her hour is come. But as soon as she is delivered of the child, she remembereth no more the anguish for joy that a man is born in the world. And ye now therefore have sorrow, but I will see you again, and your heart shall rejoice, and your joy no man taketh from you." Now these are the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. And these words are true yet today. Jesus was speaking to His disciples. And Jesus knew that their hearts were going to be heavy, and that they were going to be sorrowful because of their close association and fellowship together while they were here upon this earth, His pursuit. And so Jesus, knowing the disciples and knowing how they felt and the closeness of the brotherhood, Jesus began to try to comfort them. And He said, "A little while, and you not see me." Jesus had already said, as my brother said this morning, "You destroy this body, and in 3 days I'll raise her up again." Yeah. I'm thankful today that Jesus was able to say that, because no other man, Brother Frank, had ever been able, and no other man will ever be able to make the statement that Jesus said when He said, "Destroy this body, and in 3 days I'll raise it up again." There's no man today that has the power of brother to make such statements, and no man that has the power of that Jesus had of the bring of this body of back to life again. And Jesus speaking unto His disciples, He knew just as Peter, when Peter's faith that you talked about Brother Frank this morning, his faith began to waver, and he began to doubt, because the King of the Messiah that they Until I go and see for
myself that this one, after a while, Jesus appeared unto them, as you said, and Brother Frank, this thing, it's too big for us to try to cover the whole territory and the whole subject. But later Jesus appeared unto these disciples, and they were terrified, the Bible says. They were afraid, and Jesus said, because that they had supposed him to be a spirit. Jesus said to them, boys, he said, come. He said, a spirit. He said, my hands and my feet, but of myself, it is I myself have made. And see the spirit, have the flesh and bones, as you see me have. And when they had not, he had not spoken, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they yet believed, not for joy, brother, and all the honey and listen, and wonder, he said unto them, have these here any meat? And these apostles, they believe not that was required, because the hearts were so filled with joy at the presence of their Savior. Once again, your sorrows shall be turned into joy. The resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ today gives us a hope that those that have outstretched us, these 64 names that were called, we've taken them down to the cemetery, and we've committed the body back to the mother dust, and the soul back to God from which it came, the spirit back to God from which it came, the soul into his presence to await the great resurrection morning. And these that we have planted in the Lord Jesus Christ, I remember, as Brother Frank quoted this morning, Paul tells us, because that Jesus has arisen from the dead, brother, you and I, we will come forth ourselves from the dead. Just as much as I believe that Jesus arose from the dead, I believe that Brother Walter Adkins, Brother Buford Clemens, Ollie Saunders, J.L. McKill, and all the saints of God, that day in the Lord Jesus Christ, we'll get up one of these mornings. My father died a few years ago, and I've missed him. But this scripture has been such a comfort to me. A little while I'll not see him, but a little while I'll see him again. The saints that have died in the Lord Jesus Christ, we miss them. We miss their faces among us today. But we have that blessed hope that Paul talked about when he said that I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them that are asleep, that you sorrow not even as others that have no hope. My, what a comforting scripture this is to the bereaved. What a comforting scripture it is to the Christian people to know that when death comes, we don't have to worry. I thought, as you read the list, Brother Clyde Bradshaw, the last time that I could make his work fast, he looked at me and he said, Pastor, he said, you've got some work to do, and I'd like for you to get it done. I said, what is it, Brother Clyde? He said, clean up your church roll. Get her clean and get her ready for the Lord, because it's not going to be long until Jesus comes. That's why I said over at the delegation room yesterday that you pastors, you preachers that are pastoring churches today, and you've got a roll of 100 or 200 members and you never see them. My, my. What are you going to do when you stand before God? Say, well, Lord, and I don't know what happened to my sister. I couldn't find them. I don't know what they were doing. The Lord, as he set you in as shepherd over the flock, brother, he said that the good shepherd would give his life for the sheep. I believe today that we pastors ought to keep the church clean, Brother Buford. We ought to know our sheep, and the sheep ought to know the shepherd. When the pastor speaks, the little sheep ought to know him. I'm not bragging today, but in my church, or the church where I pastor, I don't have to even look back at my choir when they stand up and say, Brother Glenn, I'd like to request prayer for my husband. Who it is. It's one of my sheep, and I can call them by name. My, today, how much more should we as the sheep of the great shepherd? I'd rather be subject to his voice and be subject to his control. And brother, you that are pastors and shepherds today, you know one of these days you can take your sheep inside, bringing your sheaves with you, rejoicing because you were faithful down to the very end. Paul said, I would not have you be in concerning them that are asleep. I'm going to choose today. We go down to the cemetery where Dad's buried, and I know her heart's heavy. She'll stand by the grave and tears will. Today, you don't have to worry about what you have to face out here in the future. The Bible said in 1 Corinthians, for as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive, but every man in his own order, Christ being the first fruit. And brother, he was the first one that was resurrected. Afterwards, they that are his at his coming. And the Bible said after that, and then cometh the end. We that belong to the Lord today, we've got all the hope in the world, brother, that God will speak one of these mornings. And when he speaks, brother, there's something going to happen. It may be while we're assembled here. It may be while we're assembled in our church assemblies. It may be out on the mound. But this, I truly believe, that one of these days you're going to hear the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ are going to rise and get up. We that live and remain will be changed in a moment, and the twinkling of an eye. Brother Frank said this morning, we'll not be changed before they get up. But they'll get up first. Then you and I are going to be changed. This old boy that you're looking at now would be able to go to that city that Jesus went away to retire. This is all the earth today, Brother Frank. And he'll have to endure the sufferings and the afflictions. Some people think because they become Christians that we're exempt from suffering and sorrow and temptation. But I say today, brother, it just gives us strength to face these temptations and the sufferings and the sorrow that we have to endure while we're here upon this earth. This one then, we'll have to just endure until it is God's good time. And then when it is his time to call me, my wife says sometimes, she says, honey, you're just going to have to slow down. You're trying to do too much. You just got yourself spread too thin. Well, you know something? I believe now I'm just about 20-some years overdue. I believe the Lord is already. Just give me about 20-some years longer to live than what I should have lived. And then, while I live here for him, I'd like to do what little I can for him.
philosophy is to do all for the Lord that I can while I'm able. And when I get to the place that I'm not able, my Lord will do for me, Brother McKeon. When the time comes for you to cross over, or me to cross over the river, the same grace that saved me from my sin, Brother, that grace will be there to carry me on over into glory. I missed the bedside of one of our fine school teachers in Logan, and she was dying, and I said to her, "Sister so-and-so, are you afraid?" "No," she said, "Brother Glenn, about every evening at 6:30, she said, "there's a little path, a little crooked path, and I look out the window about the same time every evening, and," she said, "I see Jesus walking into my room." That was her assurance that Jesus would be there. My good old grandfather that preached the gospel 63 years, one night in the morning hours, he got up from the bed and sat on the edge of it and placed his feet on the floor. And he said Jesus was standing at the foot of his bed. And Jesus looked at him and told him, "No, not yet. It's not time, just a little while." I visited the saints of God that have been dying, and you preachers have too. How that Jesus had to be present for them to leave a little smile upon their faces as they were taking that last breath of life. My brother, when he died, mother's presence. Or he went into a coma, he raised up on the bed. Clapped his hands, said, "Listen. Listen to that beautiful singing." Sis went over and said, "What did you say?" He said, "I'm sorry, sis." She wasn't a Christian. He said, "I'm sorry, sis." Said, "You can't hear this kind of singing." To hold on in the day that that old great adversary is so powerful and working so hard, that we'll hold on to the unchanging hand of the Lord Jesus Christ. Then we can be in that number that Brother spoke about, Brother Buford and Brother. Right, baby. And they said, "Who are these?" The revelator, the Lord was speaking to him. "These are they who have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb. Made their robes white in the blood of the Lamb." I'll tell you today, if you're a Christian, you've got more today to live for than anybody else in the whole world. If you're a child of God, And you don't know where your next meal is coming from. You're still richer than the richest man that's outside of Christ. Hold on, because if you have sorrow over these that have outstripped us, life is swiftly passing by. In just a few more days, we'll lay down our works here, and we'll join them over on the other side of this world. I wasn't going to use this, but I used it so much that I let it go out in my closing thought. For this, for that Paul was down, I believe, in Ephesus, the 21st chapter of the Acts of the Apostles, and Paul had spoken to his people. And after his speaking, they came and they hugged him, planted kisses upon his neck. And their hearts were sorrowful, not much of what he said, but because they said they would see his face no more. And the Bible said they accompanied him onto the ship. That's as far as they could go, Brother Buford. But you know something on Paul when he called on that ship, he knew. He knew where she would anchor. He knew the destination of that ship. As that old ship began to sail out over the sea, the storms may have been rough, but Paul knew the pilot of the ship. I say this, that my life and your life is like a ship that's on the ocean. We're traveling today. And on this side of the ocean, or this side of the shore, we've made real friends. And we're real companions. Not a good wife. But one of these days, she'll have to stand. And I'll have to stand. And I'll have to watch that ship, the one over the horizon. Somebody on this side of the shore, they'll say, well, the ship is gone. It's gone, but no, the ship hasn't gone. It's just out of sight. Over on the other shoreline is a host of brothers and sisters, and those that love Jesus in life, and they're standing, and they say, here he comes. Here he comes. I see him. He's arriving safely. My, won't it be worth it to live for the Lord Jesus Christ? Let's work and be faithful. Till the moment that Jesus comes, when he comes, what a glorious time it's going to be. I want the quartet and the choir, to give us a number. Today, while they stand and sing with us, our message has been broken. But I want you to know this. Father, not for the hour is coming that all men of grace shall hear the voice of the Son of God. They that have done good shall come forth to the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil to the resurrection of damnation. I listen to me, that they may not be too far away. And I'd like for everyone that's under the sound of our voice to hear that great voice when God speaks, so that we can go to heaven together. Let's stand, please, while we stand.